bake too, and they could definitely get a piece of pie that were available to them.
Does anyone else have any questions? Yes.
When you guys had free time, what did you do?
Sleep.
This concept is familiar, and yet what are you referring to?
All right. I have to admit, I had one day off. It was Mother's Day. And all the guys in my section got together, and they split up my shift. So they all took a couple extra hours so that I could have Mother's Day off. So I did get one day off. We tried to make sure that all of our soldiers had at least a little bit of downtime. Again, the opportunity to get some laundry done, just to read a book, to watch a DVD. But you're working 12 to 15 hour shifts every day, and that's just those of us that were in the headquarters. Now you get into the guys who are out doing the door-to-door searches, and their hours were much longer and much harder. So comparatively, we certainly had it much better than the soldiers that were actually out in Iraq that were looking for the unexploded ordinances and that were looking for the insurgents. So.
We did have in the location, for most of us, we were at the forward operating base, Danger. Not the best name, I thought, but we're going to Danger. We're like, we know we're in danger. We know that. But that was what the actual location was called. And because we were kind of that rear support, so to speak, even though your days were long, there were opportunities to get to some of the facilities that the morale and recreation, the MWRs, the morale, welfare, and recreation organization had in place over there. So there was a palace that had pool tables, something else. I didn't go there very often. What else did they have there? Yeah, they had movies, they showed movies, and they had a makeshift dance club. Yeah, that was a little weird. A juice bar, near beer. So for those soldiers who had a, you know, had that urge to go to the club, they could do that in uniform. But nevertheless, there were opportunities for us, if you could take them, to try to make our stay wherever we were a little more pleasant. When I was off, I worked a 10-hour shift. I would just stay and work some more. I don't know if that was because I was a supervisor of the shift and I felt like there was more to do. Plus, I had two others on the day shift that I wanted to keep an eye on, but a lot of us just tended to throw ourselves into our work because that's what you were there for, and you wanted to make sure we got it done right in hopes maybe that at some point we didn't have to return. At least that was my thought, but more importantly, to make sure for me and my point of view, to make sure the soldiers on the ground had the best support possible. So. But we had some downtime, but most of it for me was really sleep. I used the 8 hours that I wasn't working to split it between hygiene and sleeping.
I was just gonna say, as a part of our schedule, we didn't like have a weekend off or days off. That just wasn't part of the schedule. We didn't do that. We just worked every day. It made the time go by faster. Once the soldiers did get off or finish what they were doing for the day, checking email, showers, and maybe watching a movie if they had a laptop or a DVD player, and then sleeping. That was pretty much the routine. The one occasion we had, we were originally on Forward Operating Base Courage that actually had a pool. So when we were moving and closing down the base, we got a half a day to actually go swimming, and it was probably the best thing you could ever imagine in that temperature to actually go in a swimming pool at one of the palaces that was rebuilt by us. Half a day of swimming, and we packed our stuff, moved to another base, and never saw a pool ever again. But the next base we moved to did have a huge MWR that had a movie theater, pool tables, lots of workout facilities to do just about anything you wanted with working out with machines and weights and classes. So there is a lot of facilities for working out and movies and pool tables, and I think they had every kind of game imaginable. So that was MRS.
For myself, when I was over there on my downtime, sleeping was a big thing. Doing my laundry was a big thing. But I also ran a lot when I was over there. It's kind of a stress reliever. I would just go out and run 4 or 5 miles just to get out to do something different.
Did you this off base or?
No, we weren't allowed to go off post. I mean, you were on base, and most times you had to have a Bible buddy with you. We weren't supposed to go anywhere without having somebody else with you, so that made it a little bit difficult. But just to get out and be able to do something that reminded you of being home, even though there's stuff still falling out of the sky when you were doing it, that was definitely something that relieved a little bit of tension.
For my part, for my downtime, I worked a 10-hour shift, and I literally stayed in the office another 1 to 2 hours just to see what was going on, because I worked a night shift. And off the high of briefing and answering questions, it's hard to go back down, so I would stay in. For the most part, I read and took online classes to keep myself occupied and did a lot of working out.
I read and slept. I walked. Did a lot of walking around. Yeah. Not chase rat, they stayed away. And and just enjoy the atmosphere. Really were. It was an experience. Quite an experience. Walked a lot.
Anyone else have a question? Yes.
They haven't told us that yet. There's always the possibility, especially like for myself. I mean, I've only been in for 5 years. So, I mean, I got another 15 years to go. God only knows, you know, if it comes up for our time to go, we'll go.
Currently, if you're in, you're most likely you're going to go again. I mean, some of us, Master Sergeant Navarro and myself, we're only one of two or three that are this rank with our specialty. So if they're going to need public affairs wherever our units go, you're
going to
go again. It's definitely
going to
happen.
Anyone else? Okay. Are there any programs in place to start to help you reach out when you come back? I'm talking specifically about people that might have to deal with post-traumatic stress disorder or other health issues that they're going back with. Shame is a veteran if you get down.
Okay, I'll field that one. Yes, there are. There are numerous. There are numerous things that are in place. The two that are widely talked about are over at the Vet Center. They have an entire unit, a clinical team that's devoted to OIF and OEF veterans. The additional resource that you have is a place called the Vet Center, which is not associated with the Veterans Administration. They're an adjunct off of it. They offer counseling services, readjustment counseling. They can also help you file if you have a disability, and they also have reemployment. So, like any of us sitting here, if we say, okay, we hit our 20, we want to go, and we want to pursue civilian education, we want to get a new job, we could go to a vet center, and they would help us out there. There's a couple of programs that offer you some educational benefits because specifically you are a veteran, and then there's some retraining programs that the New York State Department of Labor offers for veterans and returning veterans. If you are determined to be disabled as a result of an injury that you received overseas, there's also additional resources that are available. You can access those either through the Veterans Administration or you can local get them through your local vet center. Oh, right, yes, and no, and they brought up an excellent point. What all soldiers are required to do right now is a post-deployment health reassessment, and you have to do it at specific intervals, and the medical staff reviews it, and if you do something like I did, like pop hot on 4 to 5 questions for PTSD. Somebody gives you a call and says, hey, what's going on? Do you know that there's resources available? Do you want to talk? P.S. There's chaplains available if you don't want to go into the civilian sector. The chaplains will talk to you about some of your experiences, and that's the newest one. And the Guard itself just started a new program. Literally just started it 2 months ago. We're doing reintegration. So we bring all of the returning soldiers into a hotel, a neutral setting, and a bunch of service providers are there with their families, and we bring service providers into that room so that I can, as a returning veteran, literally just walk around the room and collect information. And the Department of Labor is there, veteran centers are there, federal government, employers are there, and then the usual organizations are there to provide services if needed. And they just set up this place so that it's not as intimidating. I can just go up and I can take a brochure without actually having to talk to people in the Office of Mental Health. It's another thing that we do to address some of the concerns.
Yes, sir.
Hi. Did any of you have any problems with members of the opposite sex in the military coming on to you, or was there a problem with that at all in Iraq? I've read some reports of sexual harassment and other things. Did any of you experience that or witness any of that?
Negative. The only experience that I can say is the second day that we were in Tikrit, we were shadowing the unit that was getting ready to leave, and it was a governor's conference, and the brother-in-law of one of the local governors came up to introduce himself to me, and I don't speak very little Arabic, and he didn't speak any English, and he was asking if I was married, and I explained that I was married, and he said that was okay. And I explained to him again that, no, I'm married. He said, no, that's okay. So then I showed him a picture of my granddaughter. So once he realized I was a grandmother, he kind of went away. So they were very respectful of me because I was a grandmother. But therefore, I was no longer a possible date. But that was the only experience I had. And I got to tell you, it unnerved me. I went into my office and I told my boss, I don't want to go back out. And he said, well, you got to go back out. And I went back out, and as it turned out, all the gentlemen that were around him were actually laughing at him and making fun of him because he tried to pick up a grandmother. So, but other than that, I didn't have any issues with our military personnel. Being female, and especially as a senior non-commissioned officer, because I had the respect of my soldiers, that equated to receiving the respect from the local Iraqi people that I was involved in. So that's my only story.
I would like to be honest, just because I haven't had an experience. I'm a little more an intimidating person, I've been told. So a guy probably would try to pick me up, especially if they got up close and saw what I looked like, they might say, yeah, it's all right. No, I'm just kidding. But I think it's about your demeanor that helps. Also, if you're in a position of authority, that helps. But that's not always the fail-safe measure. We know that it happens because just as human as we are on our soil, soldiers are human abroad as well. So there have been incidents where another soldier has violated the space of a female soldier. So it does happen. It's minimal and obviously not condoned by the military at all. So there are consequences for that behavior. But I don't want us to lead you to believe that it doesn't happen. It's a sad thing. Anywhere it happens, any form or out.
Any other questions?
If you're a woman in the service and you want to start a family, are there any options there? Do they put you on leave? If you're like a woman in the service, like you guys are, and you want to start a family, are there options there where they put you on leave? Because I know of people that have been fathers that have been chipped away. And so what is it for a woman?
It's required by the military for you to have a family support plan. Family care plan. Family care plan.
Hold on, there's a couple of parents up here. it's kind of twofold. We're talking both if you're in a combat or deployment situation, or if you're just a member of the National Guard or a member of the regular military. It depends on whether or not your spouse is in the military or not. It also depends on there is an 8-week maternity leave, same as you can get for most of your civilian employments. As far as when it comes to deployment, as Sergeant Coolidge was saying, every soldier who has a family is required to do a family care plan. So that identifies that my husband is not in the military, there's no chance that he's going to get deployed while I'm deployed, therefore he's the primary caretaker of my family while I'm gone. If I'm a single parent, and there's a chance I could be deployed, I have to identify either a family member or someone else that's going to take responsibility of my family while I'm deployed. So the military wants to make sure that you have plenty of time to coordinate that in advance of the possibility of you being deployed. Does that answer the question?
Yeah. What if, like, you're pregnant, would they deploy you?
No.
No?
No, if you're pregnant, you are considered medically, you are not deployable soldier. So you have to have a period of time for delivery, and then you have that 8 weeks post-delivery before they can reevaluate you to determine if you're medically fit for deployment.
I would like to add that if you are dual military, both husband and wife are in the military and have children, they can and have deployed both because of the needs of the Army. And that's why the family care plan is supposed to be in place as soon as that situation arises in your household. So as soon as you marry another service member and you have children, you must implement the family care plan at that time. I'm a single parent, so I had a plan in place. It worked. My son was well cared for. But I'll tell you, whether you're a single parent or not, that's one of the worst things that you have to do is to take up and leave your son or daughter with someone else to raise them. No matter how much you love that person that's taking care of your child, there's no replacement for the presence of a parent.
How do you guys feel about the views of the presidential candidates on the topic of keeping troops in Iraq or taking them out?
I'd have to say from the standpoint that as soldiers, we don't make policy. We follow what our leaders tell us and what they direct to do. As far as candidates, you know, they're going to say what they want and what they think is going to get them elected. Whether or not that happens to be the case once they're elected, it has been traditionally, you know, comes and goes depending on who the candidate is. So I don't base what I do based on what their campaign promises may or may not be. But again, when it comes down to it, as soldiers, we're obligated and when we sign saying that we will protect and defend our state and our nation, that we will call people who are called to duty, we will do that.
Yeah, I know I'm the blabbermouth here, but it's important for you folks to know that it doesn't matter what the position it is of the current administration. It doesn't matter if we personally agree with it or not. Most of us will not give an open opinion. We support our president and all that he's appointed to make decisions as they're directed to do. I will say that because we don't think in that way, we think about each other. I thought about my roommate, and if she was going to rely on me to make sure that she was up and ready if I was on the night shift and something happened, she should have security that I was going to take care of her. Any of us, I don't think that we had time to think about the political position and why we were there. It was about making sure all of us came back home safely. So soldiers most often only look at their particular mission, their responsibilities, and that's our focus when we're over there, to come back home to all of you.
Okay, and then I ask a question. Someone referred to email. How did you keep in contact with them? Did you have email? Did you have cell phones? How about blogging?
We had emails. I mean, I was lucky enough in the position that I was in doing public affairs. We had to be in communication all the time. We were constantly sending stories and photos back to the civilian world, so we needed to be up for years. So I had ready access to email. The MWR centers, the morale and welfare centers, also usually have computers for soldiers to be on email. So that was huge, even though some soldiers chose to write, but I was definitely an email person. I could knock out, you know, 20 or 30 a night a lot faster. So that was the communication method. We were not supposed to have cell phones, even though there was people that did have cell phones. Your cell phones won't work there, but there are certain cell phones you can get in country that will work, even though that communication, usually in the area, certain areas, you're not supposed to have them. So communication back. Phone calls were really difficult. There's what, an 8-hour difference in time. So, you know, you're trying to figure out what time it is here, and can I call, and when they're home, I'm sleeping. And then if you were lucky, it might take 10 minutes to try to get a phone line out, and then if you were lucky, you might get maybe another 5 minutes on the phone before it cut off. And there was a really odd delay where we were, so if I would call my godchild and she couldn't hear anything, she just hung up the phone. So that the phone calls were difficult where we were.
I communicated via email when I was able to use instant messaging. And also we had
webcams, and we had a personal webcam account, and we set up a webcam at home. So we had one soldier that watched his young daughter literally grow for the year that we were gone. That was how he communicated back and forth. But that opportunity, again, it was a soldier that happened to work in an office, that happened to have email access on a pretty routine basis. I'd say for the majority of soldiers, though, that opportunity is not available. We're talking about the phones. In many instances, you may be standing in line for an hour. There may be 8 phones available for 300 people. So depending on when you got in line and if the phones were actually working when it came your turn, you know, so trying to set up something like that was very difficult because you just didn't have enough time. Even with the email access, for the majority of soldiers, you'd only have 5 or 10 minutes on the computer because some other soldier is waiting in line who also wants to try to write home, so.
Anyone else? Okay, before, okay.
Your personal experience, if any of you think that there will be a day that you can get out of the troops
or I'm sorry, your question.
Do you think there'll be, from your personal experiences, do you think there'll be a time when we don't when the troops are ready?
You know, that's a tough one. I from my personal experience, my personal opinion here, if you look back at history, you guys are in a history class, and if you look back at World War I and World War II, you look at the transition and the timelines that it took for Europe to recover from World War I and World War II. And we still see a presence there. But it's a somewhat a security presence. But to what role they have in the actual government or in taking place in Europe is much different now than it was originally. I don't know. I don't know. I can see where, based on history, I can see that having a presence there would be a support to the Iraqi people as they're rebuilding their constitution, as they're rebuilding their government, as they're building their infrastructure. In the year that we were there, we saw, I think it was something like $4 billion was spent on rebuilding the infrastructure of Iraq. We saw the power plants that were rebuilt, the pipelines that were rebuilt, the hospitals, the clinics, the schools. And it was over 130 schools and clinics were built just in north central Iraq in the time frame that we were there. So we see a lot of progress, but it takes the Iraqi people now to stand up and be able to continue that progress on their own. Whether or not we're going to be there to assist, I don't know. That's all.
Okay, I'm going to ask a final question. Before I do, Charlotte, would you stand, please? I'd like to introduce Charlotte a little later. Charlotte Hauser, who is a senior at Saratoga Springs High School. This summer, after she graduates from Saratoga, she will be attending the United States Naval Academy in Annapolis. She received an appointment from Congresswoman Gillibrand. Congratulations. Do you have any questions?
No, I just wanted to thank you all for so much.
Okay, thank you. Okay, from the book I talked about, Band of Sisters, one of the quotes that one of the soldiers in the book said that deployments like life have their highs and their lows, their ups and downs. Could you tell about some of yours while you were there? And finally, how do you think your time in Iraq maybe had an effect on your life? I wasn't going to start with that one.
I am a strange one. I am odd because to me, I'll just be up front. Right. Deployment for me was, you know, a typical day. I didn't have any horror stories. I just didn't. I mean, it was an army life, and you just adjust to whatever is happening around you. But that's me, because I observed other things that people were having difficulties adjusting to. But that's my demeanor, my personality. But the most difficult thing that was related to the deployment that still kind of haunts me today is my son believing that the Army was more important than, you know, being with him at home. And it's not. It's, you have to make a choice. You look at your family and you say, I want you to carry on. I want you to carry on in the same way that you've grown accustomed to. And someone has to do it. Someone has to go over there to secure our freedom. And so you leave your family behind with the best support system that's in place, and then you do what you have to do. You're strong and you fill that gap where it's needed so that the soldiers are supported, so the soldiers that do go forward can do their jobs. And that's what I did, but it still haunts me that my son would think that anything is more important than him. It's not. The greater good was to go over and do my part in trying to secure freedom for all of us. And I don't think that anyone can argue that point. We went over, we served because we believe that we are guaranteeing all of our freedoms, our nation freedom from this day forward.
That's a tough one. I would say probably the best thing, the high point, will be the relationship that I built with my soldiers, the camaraderie, and a friendship. And when you rely on someone on a day-to-day basis, you know, and you're willing to give your life for them, that builds a bond that I don't think you really have with anyone else, and that bond will always be there with those soldiers. On the low point, and mine's probably more of a unique situation, my 21-year-old son passed away while I was deployed in Iraq. He was born with a congenital heart defect, had learned that his condition had deteriorated while I was in Iraq, and did not tell me because he was concerned that my focus would be on him rather than the mission that I was required to do. For me, going on deployment was a culmination and an opportunity to give back to the military the 20 years of training and education and leadership that I had learned through the military. When I made a decision to go ahead and deploy because of his cardiac condition and my husband's disabled, I was given the opportunity not to deploy because of that family care issue, and I chose to go because of my soldiers. My son knew that. My son believed that it was important for me to do that. Because of his cardiac condition, he was not able to be in the military, and that was something that weighed very heavily on him. So for me, coming home to bury my son was probably the low point. Well, it was definitely the low point. But I also talked to my family and made a decision that after we went through the services, I returned to Iraq. And my 14-year-old daughter and my husband were extremely supportive because they understood that that's where I needed to be and that my focus needed to be bringing my soldiers home because I brought them to Iraq and it was my responsibility to bring them home. So in the same sense that children deal with things differently, I was very fortunate that my children understood my passion and my desire to serve the country and what we felt as a family was my obligation to the military.
I'd have to say the high point was just getting to go, as strange as that sounds, because you watch a lot of your friends go, and you want to go with them, you want to do what you've been trained to do, you want to get in there with them. And watching them go without you is kind of difficult. So I had been sitting and watching for a long time and watching people go, and finally when I knew there could have been a need, I was constantly asking, do you need me to go, do you need me to go, do you need me to go? Finally, when they said, you're going, you know, I was just very nervous of the situation, but excited to be going and doing what I was trained to do. That was the high point. Unfortunately, 3 months in, you know, I was there to do a job, I had to be taken out, I was medically evacuated out. Did not want to leave fighting, kicking, and screaming, saying, this is where I need to be. I need to be with my unit and with my soldiers. Unfortunately, I didn't have that choice. So going through the process of being in an Iraqi hospital with Iraqis, with Americans that were blown up, being the only female, them not knowing what was wrong with me, very scary, thinking I was going to die, and I'm in an Iraqi hospital, and I can't get the kind of, you know, service that I need. Going to Germany, again, not being able to take care of me. And these are weeks that go by to try to get you back to the United States, being very scared, being alone. Getting back to the United States to an Army hospital that still didn't know how to take care of me. So 30 days in, I was still, couldn't walk, thought I was going to die, and knew I needed to get serious medical care. That's a real low point, especially being alone. I think most people, when they're sick and hospitalized, are used to having somebody there. That was hard. Finally sent to a civilian hospital that did diagnose me. But that process, I think it will haunt me forever. I do have lasting effects from that that I will probably deal with forever. And that's a hard thing to know, that sometimes soldiers do not always get the care that they need. It's just not available. There's not MRI machines over there. It's not even an option. A soldier has to leave Iraq to get an MRI. They have to go to Germany. So that can be scary, and I'm sure that will follow me.
I had a couple of high points. I think the best way to summarize it is when we had a success. So you would work for months at a time because of a different work ethic, a different cultural ethic. What might take me 3 weeks to do took a couple months. But when paper went to print for the first time that they had produced with their stories, or the first time we flipped a switch and we heard them over the radio waves, or we saw them on a television waves, those were really high points, because it's like, look what we were able to do. And then you could see the pride radiating in their faces, and you could just sit back and go, you know, I helped make that happen. How cool is that? So that was definitely a high point, and that happened number of times while I was deployed. On the flip side of that, the low points were definitely when contractors get killed for talking to me. You don't associate with Americans. People were killed. My producers were killed. I had to identify people. That's going to forever haunt me, because they only wanted what was best for their country, and because they were caught talking with an American or working with an American, they were killed for that. And I think that forever, that will probably haunt me.
I think my high point was definitely the camaraderie that I made with soldiers over there. I met some amazing people, and I still talk to people from all over the country. Everything that everybody had to offer, and it's something that you just don't get to see when you're home. Like Sergeant Lindsay said, when you have to rely on somebody every single day, it shows a lot. The low point was actually probably about a month before we left home. Actually, I had to go see Sergeant Lindsay. One of my jobs as being an intel analyst was to report our killed in action and our wounded in action to our general every day. And not only did we have to do it for our area, we also had to do it for the surrounding area. So we had to total everybody up in Iraq. And we were so close to going home, we got hit hard one day. And after being over there for a year, you get to a point where it's just numbers. And I think that day it just hit me suddenly. It was like, we're so close to being home, and these are still people. And I had to go see Sergeant Lindsay.
The high point for me was definitely the relationships that I built. I have soldiers that I will forever keep in my heart, because they helped me get through a tough time. The lowest point for me would be leaving my family. I'm in a unique situation. I was a widow before this war started. My husband was not a soldier. So when they approached me into deploying, I actually had to sign a waiver. So if anything happened to me, my daughter would not be able to see the military or put me in harm's way. I decided to go because as a leader, I was a lieutenant at the time. I felt that you lead from the front and not from the rear. I couldn't stand and encourage soldiers to go and tell them to go if I wasn't willing to go by myself, for my own self. The hardest part was leaving my daughter. After she was about, I would say, 7 or 8, we traveled the world together. She's been on every military base and institution that I've attended schools with. So this was the first time that we were able to be separated for a long period of time. Coming back was hard. because it was a readjustment period for her, as well as for myself. It's one thing to go and be a soldier, have a world away. It's tougher coming back to being a parent to a child who's now angry at you for leaving. So that would be the worst, lowest point in my life. For the most part, she's dealing well now. And I'm beginning to see the fruits of our labors, because now she understands that freedom is not free, that there are soldiers every day dying to make sure that we have the right to say what we say here in America.
Okay. High point for me is the relationships that I've built. My roommate. We still call each other roommate. Definitely, that was just an honor to serve with a lot of the soldiers that I served with. I had a few low points while serving in Iraq, because I saw on the SIPNet, which is one of the security computers, whenever there was a KIA, and a lot of time I read how it happened, because we had very limited time to get the soldiers' awards together so the soldier can be buried properly. And each time there were incidents, I felt, didn't know the soldiers, but you felt, for me, I felt it was a strange feeling. It's not, the words can't say bad or sad, that doesn't describe it, because you know it was a fellow soldier that may have lost an arm, a leg, or killed in action. In preparing those awards, you felt it, and a lot of times didn't have time to really work with your emotions, because you everything's time sensitive, you have to get it out there before the media, before it gets into the media. So reading those reports were very challenging at times for me. Another challenge was my son. He was a senior then, and we did everything together during high school. And I left at a time he was preparing for applications to go to different schools and writing reports. And although he tried to send his write-ups to me and applications to me by email, it wasn't the same. So he understood, but in his emails, I can tell he wasn't really accepting my not being there with him, because I would go to all the schools he plans to attend and visit with him. So it was a challenge for him, leaving him, and he did well, and he did it all on his own, and he got accepted in the school he wanted to. He wants to be a doctor, so. But you can still tell from time to time he would still talk about my not being there. And as a result, now he's so much more independent. And that's good and bad, because sometimes I want him to tell me what's going on in school. But again, I guess that it taught both of us how to be independent in different ways. And he broke off faster than I was ready to allow him to break off, because he's still, you know, a sophomore in college, and I wanted to be there more with him. So it was a challenge for both of us, and that was hard to deal with, and at times it's still hard to deal with, because I'm still thinking of him as, you know, talking with me regarding everything he was doing, and he's not doing that anymore. I know that happens when you go to college, but I think my mind is still back when he was a junior senior. So it's quite a sacrifice doing what we do, and I'm not apologizing for anything. He knows that, and he wanted me to go, because I spent a long time with him what was going on and our call to duty, and he understood that. And he said, Mom, I want you to go ahead and do what you want me to do. But, and this was, he knew it was important for my going over with the unit. But at the same time, I can tell that he held on to his feelings so that I can go without feeling bad. That was the whole point. And now we're able to speak about his feeling then. But initially, he wasn't speaking with me regarding how he felt when I was out. But we can do it now.
All right, before we end, there's some slides. Photo slide. Before we end, I don't get anything before selling this book, but we do have copies in our bookshop if you would like to look at it. And something that I just, Wayne that worked with me just gave me, the new BMW magazine. You probably wouldn't have seen this 5 years ago or so, but the women veterans, and it's honoring the women veterans who have served in Iraq and Afghanistan. I'd like to thank all of you for attending and for your patience and your attention. And I would like to thank all of you for serving our country. And thank you very much. It was an honor to have you here. No more questions for me today. I think all of you will be here. Any questions afterward? If you'd like to talk to any individual?
Yeah, luckily we wore the vests and the helmets. We went off base, and I don't know how much everybody else was wearing them, but they are heavy. The vest is probably 10, 15 pounds, and then you put the plates in, and it's 30 pounds, and then you put your ammo on, and it's probably 50 pounds. A lot of weight to carry. I know a couple times when I, to travel anywhere, we had to go in Stryker vehicles, these big vehicles, and they were all enclosed. And by the time you put all that gear on, it was 130. 30 outside. I know a couple times I was like, you're green. I mean, I would just turn white or green just from sitting and not being able to breathe and all that equipment on and trying to catch your breath and be able to maneuver in it. I can't imagine how soldiers that are over there in these vehicles traveling, doing it every single day, because I didn't travel that often, but there are guys doing it every day in temperatures with gear on that I can't imagine how they do it.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Maybe. But I was
Thank you.
Sorry.